What's vital to the future of Kansas City is that first, we have more Kansas Cityans. That would be good, right? Because you need population to fill these stores and ride the streetcar. But you also need to say, and how do we have it be a place that people of all walks of life want to live? That's, I think, what the key question is. A booming city doesn't always lift all boats. And what we need to make sure is that we do have a rising tide that does so. I'm concerned that we don't right now. To an extent, we have to get out of our own world and challenge ourselves in a fundamentally different way.
Gentrification, is it happening? Could it happen? Is it bad? It's a funny word. If you imagine that word meaning an existing neighborhood that has a certain physical financial level under which it operates, and then the neighborhood has a major influx of new people that have a higher maybe physical descriptive standard of what the neighborhood should look like and have more powerful financial means, and then they use a combination of those to sort of change the character of the neighborhood. If that's what you mean by gentrification, yeah, that's happening in my community.
The Westside is one of the, I think, most vibrant and unique neighborhoods in Kansas City, and it is complex and it is changing, and absolutely we are seeing gentrification on the Westside.
With the segregation and the isolation and the redlining and the urban renewal and no investment, and now you're coming to them saying we're gonna gentrify you and you expect them to be happy about it? No, they're not gonna be happy about that. And I wouldn't blame them one bit if I smacked you right between the eyes.
Back then, the West Side was a poor area that had housing, affordable housing. And so those individuals that decided to call the West Side their home created a community.
If there's one neighborhood where there's gonna be a fight, a confrontation, or a negotiation about what happens there, it's gonna be that neighborhood.
And then the big thing that I want you to take away from tonight is that this is the start of a conversation, because I wanna make sure that we have the opportunity as a neighborhood for everybody who wants to have a seat at the table to have a seat at the table and make sure that we're all working together for the West Side to be exactly the neighborhood that we want it to be.
Not all gentrification is bad, maybe for you, but what about the community that's already there? How are you engaging with this community?
The West Side neighborhood, I think everybody will agree, has experienced a lot of gentrification pressure over the past decade, and it's been good to some people and not good for a lot of people.
I say from the West Side, I've grown up in what I call brutally inclusive community politics. I mean, like, brutal, man. Get ready.
We want to make our own decisions. That should have been brought to the neighborhood, and you didn't.
You have a lot of people in our neighborhood who are very passionate about our neighborhood. They don't call us the Wild Wild West for nothing.
We kind of feel like we're experiencing mass differences.
We have a history of trying to keep our community an ethnic community. Not once in your proposal have you said anything about maintaining an ethnic character in this community.
One of the hardest issues is making sure that you celebrate and protect your existing neighborhoods while not turning a back on progress.
The biggest community meetings are always about new developers.
You know, what we see at times with some developers is like, well, you know, the city says I can do this, so this is what I'm gonna do. And then the residents have to go and remind the city, well, wait a minute, you made amendments to this plan and you're not upholding it. And so then we get into this fight, and sometimes you come out of it where there is a compromise that benefits everyone, and those are the Via the Soul projects. And then there's other times when you get projects like, gee whiz, I mean, how did this happen?
Gentrification and its threats actually really do fundamentally affect, I think, the social fabric of a community. And if we want to keep a community that's interesting and dynamic and that supports public transit and supports all of the infrastructure investment we've made in Kansas City, then we need to keep our mind on that. Particularly when we're talking about urban redevelopment, urban infill, so much of our policy answer is to say, let's make it like the suburbs, right? We can bring people back from something.
I mean, you're basically trading people for one, because all of a sudden that area is attractive, that area is marketable, and disregard for the people living there. That's not the right way to rebuild urban cities.
When it comes to affordable housing, quite frankly, when you get to looking around and you get to looking at the numbers, you're going to find that on the West Side, we're pretty lucky. There are two HUD complexes in our neighborhood, West Bluff and Villa del Sol is there. Villa del Sol is a unique, wonderful complex.
One of the first projects in the country, it took new legislation working with HUD where they removed the projects, built a new project, and it made it a combination of LIHTC, low-income housing tax credit, some Section 8, voucher housing, and market rate.
The benefits are that as gentrification occurs in the neighborhood, there is affordable housing there that is there in perpetuity. So those income ranges will not change as long as that development is there. And it was very important to the community.
Now that project is about, 17, 18 years old. It still looks new. And it lives and is integrated in our community.
People always assume that people of different races won't live together. And that assumption carries into income. People assume people of different incomes won't live together. And this development proves all that wrong. So that communities can develop and can grow and thrive when there are people of different age groups, incomes, and races all working together because they believe in the same community values.
The one thing that I know about the West Side is the men and women who have lived there for generations want to work hard to kind of save their community. And so it's a difficult task, but it's one that I think is worth fighting for.
The West Side is moving. It's a lot better than it used to be, I'll tell you. A lot better. And I've been here 57 years.
When I came to the West Side, my intention wasn't to be a gentrifier, and it wasn't to run anybody off. Sometimes, unfortunately, it's really tricky. I wake up with a stomach ache sometime and think, did I create the force for displacement by taking the things that were vacant? And it's like, okay, if I say, yeah, I did that. And so now, really, Jones, you didn't do what you wanted to do, man. When people start sending you letters asking you, I want to buy your house. I don't want all my old neighbors getting a letter like that.
They leave notes, send me notes here all the time. They want to buy the place. I'm not going to call no names, but it's quite a few around here want it very bad. But I'm going to let my son take it over.
I don't have a problem bringing new people in here. I think that's good, but not at the expense of the ones that have been here before. And so that's the struggle that we face now. I'm worried, as with all this new influx of people, that the next representative for this neighborhood might not be as supportive and would have a completely different mindset, would be more in line with the downtown developers. And if that happens, the gentrification of this community is just going to be exacerbated.
Tell you what, the worst way to gentrify, in my opinion, is when you get the government to do it with you. And it happens all the time. Right? They say, hey, we need to build population downtown. How can we do it? Hey, let's bring in a lot of low-income housing tax credits and all of that. Then we can get people in the city market and downtown. How cool is that? So that only a generation later, you have this situation where, hey, let's incentivize a bunch of luxury housing and other sorts of things that these people could absolutely never afford. And what's more, the low-income housing tax credits will roll off, so therefore we actually can't keep those people there. And these are people that often are working. These are people that are engaged and active in our economy. So these poor people who pay taxes too, right, are helping finance their own removal. It's kind of on us. It's on the people watching. It's on the people that participate to say, wait, before you tell me about the next big thing, how are we going to actually make life better for people who live here?